said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet he shall live. And whoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Scripture goes on to say, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. And Thomas said unto him, Lord, we do not know the way you go. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and life. No one cometh unto the Father but by me. Of course, Romans 8. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution, or famine or nakedness, or the sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are acquainted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. congregation. Ushers, if we're able to fit everybody in with such a large family and a large congregation today, thank you so much today. So good to see so many people who have gathered today to celebrate the life of our friend and loved one, Carl Petten. Today, he would want this to be a celebration. Of course, this is his birthday, and today we have come to celebrate his life. Today, I would like to say some thank yous today. We want to thank Moore's Funeral Home for their professionalism, as always. And a pleasure to work with you folks. Special thank you to Michael, who made special arrangements to this day and to make this happen. Thank you so much, Michael. We want to thank everybody that has been involved today. As well, we would like for you to know that this funeral service is live streamed to our Facebook page, Puerto Grey Pentecostal Tabernacle, and also a little later today, it will be uploaded to YouTube. We kindly ask, if any of you have your cell phones on, we ask that you would put them on silent for the service. Today, we are privileged to welcome some special guests today that are amongst us. We want to welcome today Ivy's co-workers and friends. Many nurses have gathered today to be with you and to show you support. And I often hear it say that nurses are like family. And today we give you a warm welcome to be with us today. We also want to acknowledge today the Coast Guard Auxiliary, Ross Petten, Jim Chidley are with us today. Thank you so much to be here and in uniform today. We also want to recognize today some members of the FFAW, David Decker and Bill Broderick, and we thank you for your attendance today. As well, there are many fish plant owners and executives that are with us today, and we give you a warm welcome. Last but not least, we want to welcome the crew and the skipper of Carl Venture today. Thank you, guys. God bless you. So good to see you among us today. This service has been planned by the family, and we will do our best today to bring celebration to the life of Carl Petten. On the inside of your bulletin today, there's a little write-up that I'm going to take the time to read today to you folks that are in attendance and to those that are viewing online. Carl was born August 9, 1963, to George and Nora Petten at the Salvation Army Grace General Hospital in St. John's, Newfoundland. Carl grew up and lived half his life in Porter Grave and the other half in Summerside, Bay of Islands. As with most of the children in Porter Grave, he started fishing at a very early age. And in 2014, he acquired the family enterprise. At that time of his passing, his commitment and his loyalty to the business continued to be his living legacy. Carl lived life to the fullest, never putting off until tomorrow what you could do today. His heart, story out of all the loves in his life, his family was the greatest. His heart was as big as the world, and he would do anything for anyone. He was unique in how he expressed his love and concern, and that's what made him special. He will be sorely missed, but remembered in our hearts and in our prayers forever. So nice. And as well, I want you to draw your attention. I will read it today, but a beautiful poem. Written by daughter Anna, entitled Our Father's Love, on the back. Please take time to read that today. At this time, we're asking a special family friend, Elisha Butt, to come, and she's going to sing a favorite and special, The Anchor Holds. And today, those that are taking part in the service will come, as it is outlined in our order of service, and today we'll celebrate the life of her.
this time I'll be doing a scripture reading. And really felt like sharing this verse from Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19, which we just sang about, which says, "We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure." Also wanted to read today from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 and 14, which says this, "Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of humankind, who have no hope." Verse 14 says, "For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in Him." Trusting with my hope in those words today. At this time, David Andrews will be praying with the prayer. The bulletin says that prayer by Dave Andrews, Ivy's uncle. Carl never ever called me Uncle Dave. He simply said, "Uncle." And I answered. And I was okay with that. So let us pray this afternoon. Let us each one get back together in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you today that it is indeed our privilege to bow in your divine presence. Lord, we are here today not of our own choosing, but we are here because you have changed Carl's plans. Lord, instead of him going salmon fishing, he went into your presence. And we believe, Lord, that if he had the opportunity, you certainly would not come back. Because he was in your presence. And so now, Lord, we have come to this celebration of his life, and there has been much grieving and much sorrow and such a surprise. Oh God, you are full of surprises. Oh God. But you are sovereign. And the word of God states that it is the Lord who causes grief and sorrow, but that he does not do it willingly. And in the causing of grief and sorrow, he also brings compassion. And he comes with love, and he comes with healing. And there is a healing balm today that has been felt by the members of these families, Lord, as they have come to celebrate Carl's life. And we have come to mourn, Lord, because not because he's in heaven. No, Lord, we're not mourning because he's in heaven. We are sorrowful, Lord, because he's left us. And we miss him. Oh God, a man that lived life to the fullest. We live every day, he loved life, and he planned that that's what we should do. We should plan. We should look ahead to the future. What we will do, the Bible says so. It says, you say what you will do next week and next year and on down into the present and into the future. Yes, Lord, we thank you that Carl was like that, but oh God. So unexpected. So, Lord, we are here today now because it is your will, Lord, that we be here. And it is your will that we do this, Lord, and this is what you have ordained. We say amen to the will of the Lord. We thank you now, oh God, we bring the family to you, Jesus, this afternoon.
And Lord, we especially bring Ivy to you, O God. We thank you for the way that you have been with her. Oh Lord, a truly accident, O God, as she has been carried to the hospital, Lord, such a traumatic time in her life. But Lord, we believe that you were with her. For she said she felt that she was being born in the arms of the Lord. And as she looked behind, she said, she only saw one set of footprints. Because she said the Lord had to be carrying her through this time. And so, Lord, we commit this service to you. People that will come this afternoon and they will say things about Carl that will be humorous, and we're so glad of that, Lord. He was very humorous. And Lord, we just ask, O God, that your blessing will be upon each one, that you will give each one clarity of speech and thought of their minds, Lord, of what they're going to say about him, Lord. And Lord, for this time now, O God, we will lay aside our grieving. We will lay aside our sorrow and we will celebrate in the midst of our grieving and our sorrow. We will celebrate the life of Carl. And we thank you, O God, now, and we ask your blessing upon us, each and every one. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
This today, and when Dave was up, he said he didn't call the call in Tonga. I don't know if I ever Carol called me at Chris, but the last day he was up in the shop about 2 weeks ago, he came in and he says, Elvis, Manish, 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 Manish. So, and even to Eugene on the boat, Eugene couldn't think who he was talking about. But it's an honor for us to do this. Today, I pray I'll minister to you.
He came to me. are many definitions of a shadow, but the one I want to tell you about today is the shadow of a constant companion or a mirrored image. At a very early age, I was known as Carl's shadow, not his brother. For most of my childhood and teenage years, I was a faithful companion who followed Carl everywhere he went during the summer months that I spent in Portagrave. In Carl's and Ivy's dating years, I'm sure, Ivy, that it seemed that you weren't just dating Carl, but that I was a part of the package as well. Whether it was going to the movies, out for supper, or driving you to and from nursing school, I was there. Ivy, I know that you were very accepting of this, because I can remember one particular occasion picking you up from the Grace residence before the cell phone days, and Carl had to page you at the door so you'd know that he was there. While you two were walking back to the truck, and you didn't see me there, you started to chastise Carl, asking him why he never had me with him. Well, we all know how Carl enjoyed so much accessorizing his truck. Well, that day, we were running a little bit late because we never had time to finish wiring up the latest set of lights that we had installed on the truck. So, actually, he did have me with him, which suggests that I was lying down on the floor, under the dash, trying to finish the wiring before it got dark. There was never any doubt in Carl's eyes that you, Ivy, was his one and only match. From the early in your dating relationship, when Carl would visit us at Summerside, every night before he would go to sleep, he would lie there in the bed and stare at your picture in his wallet. Or when we'll be dropping you off at the residence after one of our dates, he wouldn't drive off the parking lot until he'd seen you wave from your room window, and he would flash his brake lights so you knew that he had seen you. Right up to the night before his wedding, I can remember seeing him jumping up and down on his bed like a five-year-old with excitement, after eating almost a pound of cheese because he wanted to make sure that the next day was perfect, not wanting to have any loose bowels. Carl was quite adventurous, as many of you here today would know, and could tell many stories. Like one time when Carl, Derek, Daryl, myself, and a couple of the other boys stopped at my cousin's shop for a snack while on my motorcycle. Many times back in those days, you would have your snacks eaten before you would pay. Carl went into the shop right away, grabbed two small pies out of the fridge, and devoured them. Derek grabbed a couple of pies as well. However, he took his to the counter to pay for them before he ate them. Ike noticed that Derek's pies were spoiled, actually starting to turn green. When Mike checked the pies in the fridge, every one there was spoiled. Carl turned, looked at the boys, and said, "I wonder, was mine spoiled too?" I don't even think I can even pay for the pies. On another occasion, earlier, in the earlier days of the crab fishery, fishermen would truck their own crab to the plant. One night, when it was Carl's turn to drive the truck, they loaded up the truck and Carl headed off across Witless Bay Line to Bay Bowls. Partway across Witless Bay Line, Carl got short taken and abruptly stopped the truck, jumped out, went up into the woods to take care of business. He got back into the truck, headed on to Bay Bowls. Before the return trip back home, Carl stopped to gas up the truck. When he was ready to pay for the gas, his wallet was missing. The only place that he could think of where he could have possibly left his wallet was back in the woods. He did find it there, in the location where he had taken care of business earlier in the evening. Actually, the wallet was buried underneath his wallet. He got a couple of sticks and managed to get some money out of the wallet so he could go back and pay for the gas. I, too, had many adventures with Carl, and many of them would often end up in Carl saying, "If your mother could see you now, you'd never be allowed to go with me anymore." Like our many motorcycle trips with me hanging on the back, probably fracturing a speed limit or two, or trying to see how big of a tree that we could pull down with the truck. If the truck was unable to tip the tree over, we all know how Carl never quit and defeat easily. It just meant that I had to climb higher in the tree to tie the rope on. Carl was also the one who taught me how to drive a standard at the the age of 13, you're probably thinking that he would have taken me to an empty parking lot somewhere while sitting in with me to give me lessons. But remember, this was Carl. I was actually in the truck by myself after Carl gave me a few brief instructions between his house and the cliff in Uncle George's old dad's. I'm sure Craig can relate to driving over a cliff as a small boy after Carl put him in the truck by himself. I fished with Carl on the Carl Venture for a few years at many different fisheries. When we went tuna fishing, every tuna that we would catch, Carl would be the man on the gaff to hook the tuna's tail to get the rope on for lifting it aboard. On one occasion, while trying to gaff the tuna's tail, the gaff broke. Carl didn't want the risk losing that fish while somebody went to get another gaff, so both him and Craig hung me over the side of the boat so that I could get the rope on the tuna's tail. Carl was a man of many talents. He was a fisherman, a carpenter, a mechanic, an outdoorsman, an avid traveler, and so many other things. And he was a perfectionist in everything he done. Whether it was the 25 different prototypes of candlesticks for Charlene's wedding before getting the design that he was happy with, or when they were building his house, it was completely framed up, walls up, and roof on, and he discovered that the kitchen and the living room level of the house was 4 inches too low. He completely ripped that section of the house down just to raise that floor 4 inches and rebuild that end of the house. As an outdoorsman, Carl enjoyed skidooing, quadding, cutting firewood, moose hunting, and most recently, fly fishing. I had the privilege of joining him during many of these outings. A lot of you would know how excited and anxious Carl would get when doing something new for the first time. I was with him when he shot his first moose. When he seen that moose fall, he jumped and danced like a child would do on Christmas morning. Carl was a man of respect and dignity. He enjoyed his play and recreation, as we all do. But he was a devoted provider, husband, father, son, and friend to all. Carl was a devoted and loyal son to Uncle George and Aunt Nora. In the absence of his brothers and sister, Carl took on the responsibility of ensuring the well-being of his parents during Uncle George's illness and beyond his passing for Aunt Norma. Carl was always there to make sure his mother's needs were met. Carl's commitment and loyalty to the family business was his continuing legacy until he passed. Of most importance in his life, his love for you, Ivy, Adam and Lori, Brittany, Matthew, Hannah, and most recently little Leo, was never questionable. His display of love and affection may not have been evident in the so-called normal fashion, but he was very traditional yet unique in how he showed it. On times when things developed contrary to what Carl thought they should, he could get a little dramatic and absolutely had no difficulty in verbalizing exactly how he was feeling. Like the time when Carl, Ivy, and the children came to Summerside for a skidoo trip, and Adam crashed his skidoo into the back of his father's skidoo. Initially, Carl responded as only Carl could do in his dramatic fashion. He informed the family that he was heading back to Dad's house to pack up the trailer, heading back to the East Coast, and anybody that wasn't there when he was ready was going to be left behind. When we all eventually arrived back at the house, Carl was not there. However, the trailer was still in the garden. Shortly after, Carl returned from Cornerbrook with all the parts needed for Adam to repair his skidoo so he didn't miss the next day of skidooing. Time would never permit me to share all the memories and adventures. And like you all here today, you could tell so much. But Carl lived life to the fullest. He wasn't one to put off till tomorrow what he could do today. Ivy, as an avid traveler, Carl's desire and plans to travel this earthly world was a new quest in your lives, and now the greatest journey has begun. We will no longer hear Carl say,
time we'll be singing the hymn till the storm passes over, and so the congregation may stand, and the waters may remain seated at this time, if you wish.
Yeah.
It's truly amazing how much your world can change in just a week. I would be lying to you all if I said I wasn't reliving August 2nd every since it occurred. My morning started the same, with Leo with big blue eyes and Goofy grin looking up at me. We were on our way to where we could get away, so Dad could catch his first salmon on the exploits. For those that know Dad well, know he always found a new hobby, and salmon fishing was the new thing. I can tell you all confidently that Dad spent his day living better than most. He was so excited, like the big kid he was, to get out on that river. But his first plan was to get to Lewisport to buy his new pole. But we all know Dad, he would have bought the whole store out with brand new top-of-the-line fishing gear since he didn't have it all yet. The smile on his face that day was the same smile we've all seen so many times. And now every morning since then, I look at Leo and I see the exact same smile. Our dad was taken too soon. My sweet baby Leo and niece on the way. We'll never get to see the way his face crinkled when he laughed, or see the endless love in his eyes. I can't count the number of times I've heard, "He's Pop's man, and Pop loves you somewhat." I can still hear you saying it in my head every day. That day during our last dinner together, unknown to us, he held Leo the whole time, smiling and laughing and telling him how much he loved him. God knew those would be the last few moments they would ever share together, and I will cherish that forever. We've had so many people say how happy Dad had been this year. It was such an amazing year for him. Started off with getting his grandson, finding out we had another grandbaby on the way, getting his brand new boat, trips to his second home in Summerside, a trip to see all the family in Fort McMurray, going out for trips in his boat around the bay, taking Leo, especially, on his first boat ride, and then his new fad of salmon fishing with his great buddies, and even a final ride on motorcycle with Mom just a few days before everything happened. This is something none of us thought we would have to write, say, or come to terms with. Today we say our final goodbyes to our dad, our mother laid to rest the love of her life, and so many have lost a brother or son and a beloved friend. Dad was, as most of you know, a character. He always had something to say to make you smile or something to tease you about. There wasn't one person Dad couldn't joke around to. He always came home from the wharf laughing at someone he was just carrying along with. And no matter if he was spending his day at the wharf, running errands, usually at Canadian Tire, or in the shed, not a day went that he didn't have a chat with at least five people. I'm sure from his days fishing, days in the woods out in the West Coast, and now salmon fishing, and his other endless hobbies, I'm sure he has plenty of stories to tell the crowd up there. I've been told it's hard to get away from my dad when he gets his stories going. I hope they're ready for him. Beyond an outdoorsman, fisherman, and storyteller, to me, Dad was a comforter, best friend, and roadside assistance. Dad gave the best hugs and always made me laugh the hardest. And even in the pouring rain, he was just one phone call away to come change my fifth flat tire and convert a brake. Trust me, Dad has a lot of flats. Most of you know our father was a lot of great things. His favorite title was husband to our incredible mother. We are so blessed to have had a father who loved our mother with incomparable measures. Though our family has lost one of the most important people to us all, we have each other. We have his undying love for us, not just for our family. It has been overwhelming these past few days to see and talk to all the people who love Dad. And I know we have a harbor full of people who can keep telling his stories for him, and our family and community can keep his memory alive.
I'm going to try. I'll just tell a funny story that we had out on the boat one time. When we first started out the trip, we weren't doing very, very good at all. There was a lot of pulling back, nothing. And by, we finally had figured out what was going on, and we made the adjustments and put the trawl back out. And then when we were taken back, I was the guy on the winch, and it's like, I think there's something in this one. And all I can hear Dad up there now, "Are you guys sure?" And I was like, we're getting back. And just we got the bag back, one of the boys shouted back and said, boy, Carl, I think he's full. There must be two there. And I was here. And he tried to jump out through the door and he hooked his 2 feet in the bottom of the door, went flat down on the deck on his knees and his hands. His hand was sore and he still ran right back to see the shrimp. Whenever he got excited, it was full. There was no in between. No, I'll never forget the cobweed.
Try to get some of these mics you can't turn on at my own church. Any of you guys ever been in a pickle? Well, I'm in a pickle right now. Carl's lost. I tell you. You're already at a cabin in the Northern Peninsula, I guess. Well, it's supposed to be my cabin. It really is his cabin. He left an axe, a trailer, a TV, a light, a generator, a rope, enough firewood for 3 years, splits, all the utensils. He hated washing dishes. All utensils, plates, you name it, it's all there. Every turn I make, there's a reminder of Carl Petten. We had a lot of new discussions. A lot of good talks. He was a good encourager to me. Over the battles that his life offered. We talked about how the just and the unjust will suffer. About a time when men would want nothing to do with God. But his name, Isaiah or Jeremiah, said it, will never be forgotten, because it will be cursed upon the tongues of men. We talked about current events. The temple for Jerusalem is on planes and ready to be built. And the caste society that the United Nations is trying to bring forth by the year 2030. And that he would be aided. And that he did nothing but good. I'm not going to preach, but I enjoyed those talks with Carl. He was amazing. He knew every button I had. He knew just how to push it. Brothers, yeah, we loved each other. We fought like brothers. We made up like brothers. And I've been sailing the seas for most of all these years. Riding the crest of a wave in tears.
Sing it with me.
I can hear Carl now. My gracious, lovely, what the world's he gone to say? And like you, Miles, he found my box still. I remember one day out in the shed, he was saying something to me when I left it before I got past the church. He called. He said, "You're mad, ain't ya?" "You're mad, me." I said, "Oh, Carl, I'm not mad at you." "Well," he said, "you're not mad, come back, yeah?" Even though I'm much younger than Carol, I consider love either me, Dad, Norman, or for Carol on a daily basis. Usually it's me with my text around 7, 8 o'clock in the morning. "You up yet?" Most texts to Dad, even up to Friday afternoon, around lunchtime, texts come in from Carol. "Where's you to?" From Skidoon to Boynton to Hunting, trips to the cabin, trips to St. John's. If we were gone, we wondered if Carol wanted to join or if Carol was going by himself. He asked one of us to go. But then again, if Ivy and Anna was gone, sometimes we'd rest. If you've seen my Facebook picture this week with me and Carol, you have seen us laughing. And whenever we were together, that is what we mostly done. We either laughed at each other's expense or at somebody else's. Carol and Ivy are great friends and a lot like family. July the 13th of this year, on my birthday, Mom and Dad and Norman's family was across the island, and I was home by myself. The text came in from Carol. "Ivy says to come up to the park for your supper." I said, "Ivy, yes, maybe. I'm sure Carol will too." And anyway, I headed over. When I arrived, I said, "Thanks for the invite, Carol. That was nice of you." That's Ivy, bye. Yeah. So the evening went on, and Ivy bought me out a cake. I said, "Thanks, Ivy, you didn't have to do that." And Ivy replied, "That's not me, my son, that's Carol." He went off looking for a cake for you. Carol said, "Yeah, right." While Ivy was barbecuing that night, the grease caught fire. Carol was over on the other side frying out fish. And Ivy sung out, "The barbecue was on fire." Carol ran over with the garden hose and drenched the barbecue. And Ivy said, "Carol, not the hose, you'll have the buns and everything soaked." And with that, he turned around behind her back and said, "Oops." About 2 falls ago, we were at the cabin, me, Dad, Norman, and Carol. Carol said, "Why, that's some strange love you haven't called me today." With that, he picked up the phone, he called Brittany around, I can't remember at the time, and asked, "What are you doing today?" They replied, "Having a surprise birthday party for Mom." His response was priceless. "What? You guys had a party for Bob today and never told me nothing about it, and I'm over here. Boy, oh boy, what the world's people going to say?" The best part was when he said, "How come you never told Dad about the party?" That wasn't very nice. The reply on the phone was, "Because, Dad, you would have told Mom." So needless to say, we made him feel bad for missing the party once he hung up. Although I unfortunately didn't get to go salmon fishing trip with Carol, Dad and Norman did. The first day in, Carol fell into the river. How he managed that, we don't know. But Norman laughed, and Dad told Norman to stop laughing and pick him up. But I mean, Carol wouldn't laugh at us. A stranger down the river said to Carol, "So what have you got there?" All they did was laugh.
was always a treat for Carl. On one particular trip, Dad and Carl were rolling down trees. And the biggest fun of the game, Luke could roll down the biggest tree. Dad went ahead of Carl and on top of a little hill and watching, waiting for him to pass by. Dad seen Carl coming down through, rolling down the trees, rolling down, and one cut his eye across the mash. And you could see the question, could I roll that one down? Anyway, he headed towards the tree. Tree never budged, Carl hit the tree right on top. He looked around to see if there was anyone seeing him. By this time, Dad was in towards Carl laughing. Carl said, why? He said, I didn't think anyone seen him. I was trying to get away before he'd come back. With Carl, it was always a good time. One day, he was down the harbor. Get aboard. I said, what for, Carl? Never mind, I get aboard. I said, Carl, what for? Where we going? Never mind, get aboard. We hopped aboard his little team. We headed off. We drove to St. John's. Down through Water Street, up to Signal Inn. I asked Carl, what in the world were we at nearly that? He looked at me and said, nothing. I said, we need some supper. So we went to Montana's for supper, we had a life was an adventure with Carl. You didn't know what you would say, what you would do, the many trips to town, the conversations in the ship that usually ended up, we should go now, not tonight. We'll truly be missed. Even though we had some good laughs together during our drives and chats, I found out what mattered most to him. His family and friends. He'd drop whatever he was doing to lend a hand or go somewhere just for a buddy for the drive. Adam, Brinkley, and Anna. I know you already know this, but your dad loved you guys and was very proud and happy of your accomplishments. There was nothing he wouldn't do for you guys. And little Leo, you instantly became his world. Love it. You meant so much to him. He reassured me that many times. Even up to last week on the way to Torres Cove, he said something about Lovey, and I said, Carol, you think something of Lovey? He replied, I do that, brother. Carol would be saying that's enough now. But I could be here for days telling stories. I will save them and cherish them. We have lost a great friend and a buddy, but we'll always hold dearly to the great memories. With today being Carl's birthday, we want to say happy birthday. And like Norman's little fellow Luke said a couple of days ago while feeling his dad's sadness, there's lots of salmon rivers in heaven, Dad. So Carl saved a salmon.
I want to thank everyone today for their willingness to be involved and to see people pay their respects to a great man who lived life to the fullest. It's so important for all of us as we are learning to live each day to the fullest. So glad today to have our pastoral team with us, Pastor Jennifer Austin, my wife, children's pastor, Pastor Isaiah Sims, our youth pastor, with us and help us on the drums as well today. It's so good to have Pastor Crane with us today, who visited family when I visit Ivy and some more family the night of the accident in Gander. And of course, my good friend, Reverend Linda, is with us today as well. We appreciate them and their support to us today. Today, for just a few moments, I want to share to the family today and those that have gathered here with us a message entitled, A Shepherd in the Desert. A Shepherd in the Desert. Father God, I thank you for this privilege that we have today to stand here with your word, the word of God. I believe that there's power and life and encouragement in your word. I pray that you would take the meditation of my heart and you would make it acceptable in your sight. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I'm sure all of us here today, no doubt many of us, have experienced good times in life. And life is full of good times, but unfortunately, and again, as many of us are aware here today, that life is sometimes full of disappointments, full of tragic moments, full of storms and trials and tribulations. You know, often in times like this, many people utter the statement, life is so fragile. Life is so fragile. You see, from sickness to sudden and an unexpected end of employment and to tragic deaths, life can be so unpredictable and unexpected. Unfortunately, in our community over the last number of days, we have become too familiar with sudden deaths. But you know what, as I've learned as a Christian and as a believer, the beautiful thing about the Christian faith today, the beautiful thing about the Christian life is that we have a shepherd. He's a good shepherd that promises us that in every season of life, through every difficulty, through every storm, he gives strength. Today, I want to proclaim to you as a family, friends, and those that are listening in online, I want to proclaim to you today that not only does he impart strength to us, but he is present. He gives courage, he gives peace, and we often talk about in times like these, and I've heard the family mention this very statement, that he has given the peace of God that passes all human understanding. You see, we're never alone. We don't do life alone in the good times, and we don't do life alone in the bad times. You know, I would say as a pastor that probably one of the most read and well-known portions of Scripture in times like these is found in Psalms 23. And I know at the close of the week last night, my wife had taken some time to read Psalms 23. And this psalm is a psalm of encouragement, a psalm of assurance that God is indeed the good shepherd. And not only is he the good shepherd in good times, but he's a good shepherd in the bad times. He's a shepherd in the desert. However, I want you to know today that sometimes, and I've been guilty of this, so I'm not pointing fingers, But sometimes in life, when we read the Bible, when we read Scripture, we sometimes view Scripture through what I would like to call a North American lens. And what I mean by that is sometimes we try to read Scripture and we try to apply it to our lives in the 21st century, and we forget that Scripture was written thousands of years ago, written to specific people groups in specific times, and when we do that, we often miss some very important lessons. We don't consider the culture or the context of when these verses or chapters were originally written. Again, we just try our best to apply these verses to our lives. And again, the problem is sometimes we miss significant pieces and meaning. So for the next couple of minutes, just bear with me. I won't be long at all today. I want to read to you Psalms 23 and share some brief words of encouragement. And we're going to read verses 1 to 4. And my Bible says, a Psalm of David. And verse 1 says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right path for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, or some translation says, through the valley shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. So here, right away, we see the psalmist comparing the Lord to a shepherd. I find that really interesting. What is it about shepherds that the psalmist would compare the Lord to a shepherd? One of the ironic things about the story of Jesus and about the birth of Jesus is the angels shared the good news with shepherds. And believe it or not, shepherds in biblical times were actually people of poor reputation. Historians tell us that because of their occupation and the pay was so low, many times they would be people who were involved in stealing and robbing, trying to make ends meet. And early writers of history tell us that shepherds had such a poor reputation that they wouldn't even allow them to give witness in a court situation. But yet, the psalmist says here that the Lord is my shepherd. One thing that I've learned about shepherds as I've studied shepherds in biblical times and even in modern times, a shepherd was actually quite a popular occupation. These shepherds are completely engulfed in their flock. It's their passion, it's their pride, it's their joy, it's everything about them. And one of the interesting things that you will notice is that the sheep always follow their shepherd. Always. And more specifically, they follow the voice of their shepherd. Another interesting fact about the shepherd-sheep relationship is that when the shepherd would gather the sheep together in a pen for a time of rest, he or she would lay across the gate so nothing could get in and no sheep could get out. I guess as I begin to study about the role of the shepherd and the relationship between the shepherd and the sheep, statements like Jesus made in John chapter 10 come flooding to my mind. Jesus says, "I tell you the truth, the man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other sort of way, is a thief and a robber. The man who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The watchman opens the gate for him, and the sheep listens to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and he leads them out. When he has brought them out on his own, he goes ahead of them and his sheep follow him because they know his voice." And so we have this information now about the shepherd and sheep, and we can see here that this relationship between shepherd and sheep was a passionate, intimate relationship where the shepherd was completely engulfed with his flock of sheep. The shepherd, you see, is close. The shepherd speaks. The shepherd watches over them and invites the sheep to follow him. And friends, I want to tell you from experience, family today, I want you to hear my heart today, that through the deepest, darkest times of our life, the shepherd is always close. He's always watching. He is always near. The Bible says that he is Emmanuel, that he is God with us. And I know these days have been dark. I know these days have been trying. But I want to tell you today that God is in the midst of us. And his presence is our source of strength. The next line of the psalm gets very interesting. The psalmist declares that the good shepherd makes him lie down in green pastures. Pretty good picture, if you ask me. Now again, in our eyes today, when we see green pastures, we see what's behind me. We see these long, lush fields of grass and trees and vegetation and food and comfort and peace and this wonderful, blissful picture of a green pasture.
However, again, that's why sometimes we read scripture through what I would like to call a North American lens. I would have you to know today that in biblical times, a green pasture is not what this would be. This is not what you would encounter as a green pasture. This is not the picture, friends. The idea of a green pasture gives us the impression, again, that we have this endless amount of supply. It's comfort, it's food, everything that we would ever dream of or want. Relaxing life, free of care and trouble, is in this green pasture. But we all know, friends, today that this is not how life operates. This is not how life unfolds. Christian or non-Christian, our lives can be filled with troubling and trialing times. That we are people that experience storms and difficulties. The Bible, Jesus himself declares that we will face trouble. Again, the landscape for a green pasture in Bible times is completely different, and we have a picture to show what a green pasture would look like in Bible times. You see, historians and scholars alike tell us that at night the wind would always come from the west. It's a warm, moist wind that carries moisture from any nearby water areas, such as that of the Mediterranean Sea. And the hillside and the cliffs. And you can see a modern day shepherd here in the left of the picture, and the sheep are down at the bottom of the picture. And you can see these sparsely amounts of grass that are growing up against the cliffs and the rocks of the desert places in biblical terrain. Quite a different picture. And so with this in mind, I want you to know here that the psalmist, when he writes about green pastures, this is what he's writing about. But friends, today, this doesn't seem like this life of free from trial and trouble and happiness. This seems like by the end of the day, the sheep will starve to death. You see, friends, I want you to know that this teaches us some very important lessons about faith in God in these difficult times and moments. You know, when life gets tough due to these unforgettable circumstances that we face here today, we can be assured today that God will give us the strength we need to get through today. I believe that with all my heart, soul, and mind, that God, by his infinite mercy and strength, will provide to us what we need to get through today. He will provide for today. Tomorrow we may not see in the natural how we are going to face things. Tomorrow we may not see how we are going to get up and move forward in life. But I guarantee you that tomorrow the shepherd again will guide us. He will be on another hillside leading us to another area of grass, even though it may seem sparse at times. But if we listen to the voice of our shepherd, he will lay us down in that place of refuge for today. And friends, I want to tell you today that in these areas of difficulty that we face in life, times will come and times will go. But I want you to know that God will be present today. He is in your midst, and he is helping you, and he is guiding you, and he is leading you to green pastures. You see, friends, in closing, family, friends, congregation, don't ever forget that he walks the dark hills. We sing that sometimes. Don't ever forget that he is present. Don't ever forget that he is real. At evening, when darkness sets in,
Instead of leading the sheep out in front, ancient and modern shepherds would then often place themselves in the middle of the flock and continuously speak and talk to the flock, that they would reach out and touch them with their rod and with their staff, so that the sheep would know that even during the darkest night, even though in the valley of the shadow of darkness, even though in the valley of the shadow of death, the sheep would know by listening and hearing the shepherd's voice, by touching and feeling the shepherd's rod and staff, they would know that his rod and staff comforts them. They would know that the shepherd in the darkest of night would come and rest in the middle of his flock. Family and friends, today our strength comes from the Good Shepherd. We know that He is with us. We know that we have a hope today, as Pastor Isaiah read about, that we have a hope of a reunion. We know today that as Christians we believe that the best is yet to come. We know today that while we wait here, while we endure the darkness of nights at times, that God is in the middle, that God is with us. He's speaking to us. He's reaching out with His arms of love and mercy to be our shepherd in the desert. He is ever present in every trial and storm. He is our portion and strength and friends. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. And today I trust family, friends, and congregation, both here and online, I trust today that you would know that He is your shepherd in your desert, in your desert. He is your shepherd. Friends, today at this time, I'm going to ask a friend of mine that I've met throughout this entire process, and through coming to know Sister Nora and her journey, I'm going to ask Charlene today to come with a thank you from the family.
Sorry, I just keep looking around because I still can't believe this is real. But I just want to say a message of thanks from the family, and it's, how can you say thank you when your heart is overflowing? Thank you just sounds so small, but there's nothing else to say. Our hearts are breaking, yet we are happy for the love of family. We are so overwhelmed by all of your support. Thank you for providing your vehicles, food, and other material needs. More importantly, for the healing comfort through your company, your laughter, your prayers, and the resurrection of so many memories. I ask us all to make sure that this is a celebration of Carl's life. I think we held up to your wishes. And if Carl was here, he would have enjoyed it to the fullest. Thank you to those who offered us beds and gave us bread. Thank you for opening up your clothing stores and providing a wide variety of shirts and ties and jackets. For those of you that lent us vehicles, I think you're going to be very happy because Zachary offered to make sure that they all go back clean and all the tanks are full. To Pastor Russ and his team, how can we say thank you for all you mean to us? We really didn't know much about you prior to this, but through these last days, you have become one of our own. Just like our brother, you have ministered to us in ways we can't comprehend, but has been our source of comfort. I would like for us to give special recognition to the following: for the efforts of the first unseen bystander, first responders and medical staff at the James Pate Memorial Hospital in Gander, your professionalism and sensitivity in our tragedy has been most comforting. To the staff at Carpentier General Hospital, Thank you for providing ongoing care to Ivy in this time of need. To Wilfred and Melanie Barrett, thank you for making the anchor that is placed on the flower arrangement. Lastly, to Michael Mercer, our funeral director, you are amazing. Your professionalism, compassion, and soft-spokenness has brought so much comfort to our breaking hearts. We know that you treated our brother with the utmost dignity and respect, for which we are so thankful. Our final note is to thank you all for celebrating this day with us, and to wish Carly's final happy birthday in this earthly life. Thank you.
This time, we are going to begin the recessional, and I'm going to ask your sister if she would lead us in that chorus hymn that Bernie and Ray sung earlier, Because He Lives, I Can Face Tomorrow. There's been a special request for an honor guard as well, official person's honor guard. And as we stand this afternoon, as the team begins to lead us in this chorus, you both can take your place on this both sides of the aisle here, and we will begin our recessional. This service will continue and conclude in its interment at Porter Grave Pentecostal Cemetery. We invite everybody to join us there today. God bless you. We are going to ask the congregation to stand at this time, and our worship team lead us in Because He Lives, as He